A staple of effective dystopian stories is the rejection of perceived societal norms and features of government, particularly in how they lead to the dystopia or post-apocalyptic setting of the story itself. In short, for a dystopian story to work, the character's growth must be tied to the story's wider theme of what causes a society to collapse, or what a society at its core actually is. The characters must realize that the lives they've lived or are trying to live are antithetical to their goals of survival, that, in short, in order to avoid a second collapse, they must do something different.
You built this place to be like the old world. That was the fucking problem. You got one enemy. We hate the walking dead.
This is what makes dystopian stories so appealing and, at times, controversial. Writers have the luxury of looking at our own world and pointing out the cracks in the foundation that may eventually lead to collapse from the comfort of a society which has not yet collapsed entirely. In telling their stories, dystopian authors and filmmakers are turning the mirror not only on their characters, but also on their audience, and an effective dystopian story should make the audience as uncomfortable with the questions at hand as the characters are. This is why dystopian stories tend to garner so much controversy and find themselves on the banned books list. If this were a more spicy channel, I would dedicate this video to the political analysis of dystopian stories generally being left-wing by nature, because they challenge the status quo and question the methods employed by conservative cultures. However, I don't have that spice, so you can think about that or be mad about it yourself. What I will say though, because it's more obviously true and I think we can all agree on it, is that dystopian stories tend to place themselves between the binary structures of governments relying on either democracy or fascism of some sort. Characters in dystopian stories generally try to expand freedoms and options for themselves by learning from the mistakes of the past regimes or governments in order to create a more open, equitable, and utopian setting than the one from which they came. In the case of the recently released smash hit film Barbie, directed by Greta Gerwig, the characters are not necessarily living in a traditional dystopian or post-apocalyptic setting or anything like that. Particularly from the perspective of lead character Barbie, who is living a life of comfort, luxury, and ignorance of the real world around her.
The best day ever.
It is the best day ever. So is yesterday, and so is tomorrow, and every day from now until forever.
As well as minor workings of her own world, such as where the Kens live. The same can be said for the character of Emmett in 2014's The Lego Movie, which focuses on Emmett waking up, some might say, getting woke, to the real world in the homogeneic way it oppresses and controls all the people around him. Both of these characters, however, are in contrast to the character of Rodney Copperbottom from the 2005 animated masterpiece, Robots. It's no Rango, of course, but it's Robots. Unlike Barbie and Emmett, Rodney's not living a life of comfortable privilege induced by homogeneity or ignorance. Rodney is the son of a poor dishwasher, and sees firsthand the dystopian effects of a setting on his family and friends. From the commodification of body parts, to lack of access to resources necessary in order to survive, to expectations about appearance, Rodney is extremely aware of the problems the oppressed in society face and endure because he is the oppressed, while Barbie and Emmett, however, are not. However, Rodney's character arc is defined by his naive belief that he alone can change things using the system as it stands, and the film ends with his realization that his success is due to the changing of the entire system with the help of everyone, rather than he himself simply becoming a part of it. Which brings me to
Part 1, The Nature of Oppression. Don't cancel me, but oppression, both in the real world and in dystopian stories, usually boils down to a pretty simple idea. One group has vast control over another, and benefits immensely from that control. The type of control or oppression really depends on the type of story. It can be environmental, economic, race-based, gender-based, or whatever. But a guy you might not have heard of called Karl Marx talked about this extensively, and divided society basically into two groups, the proletariat and the bourgeoisie. Marx believed that the bourgeoisie, or rich ruling class, could only maintain power and privilege by taking advantage of and exploiting the lower class, the proletariat. This dichotomy of oppressed and oppressor is present in Barbie, The Lego Movie, and Robots, though the nature of this dichotomy is different in each film. In Barbie, the dichotomy is obviously based on gender. In the beginning of the film, Barbie Land is portrayed as a utopia where all positions of government are filled by women, everyone is happy all the time, and there's no political strife of any kind. The Kens aren't explicitly mistreated, but they lack any real agency and are largely ignored in matters of importance and treated like ornaments. Sound kind of familiar? Because, you know, I think it's supposed to. In the Lego Movie, the dichotomy is a little more complicated, but it essentially comes down to government versus its people. The ruling class is occupied exclusively by present business, which is obviously a thin metaphor for the dangers of plutocracy and the chain big business puts around democracy, as explored in the nonfiction work Democracy in Chains by Nancy MacLean. A very Marxist idea. President business also controls all of the elections, energy, entertainment, etc., and in this case, the oppression is similar to that of Brave New World by Aldous Huxley, and that people are controlled and distracted by shiny objects, senseless popular entertainment, and a false belief that they are living the best lives they can, and that the only threat to this utopia is people or things that are different. President Business is your typical autocratic demagogue who maintains and drives power from a fear of people who might upset the status quo by questioning or challenging the societal structures built on a foundation of absolute normal. Again, just like the people who want to ban or hide from dystopian works like The Handmaid's Tale. This is reminiscent of a George Orwell quote from literally 1984 when he says, "It was possible, no doubt, to imagine a society in which wealth, in the sense of personal possessions and luxuries, should be evenly distributed, while power remained in the hands of a small privileged caste. But in practice, such a society cannot long remain stable, for if leisure and security were enjoyed by all alike, the great mass of human beings who are normally stupefied by poverty would become literate and would learn to think for themselves. And when once they had done this, they would sooner or later realize that the privileged minority had no function, and they would sweep it away. In the long run, a hierarchical society was only possible on a basis of poverty and ignorance."
Step 13, enjoy popular music.
Jump the charts again, it's Everything Is Awesome.
Oh my gosh, I love this song.
Everything is awesome.
In the Lego Movie and Barbie, poverty is not so much the tool employed, but ignorance. This is partly academic ignorance, but mostly it's ignorance through lack of awareness about the plight or experience of anyone other than yourself, or Barbie and Emmett to be specific. This is a classic method used by fascists to maintain control. The privileged are kept unaware of how the truly privileged, i.e. the rich and powerful, are treating the lowest groups of society, so that clamors for help from below and efforts to enlist those who are just a little better off turn from pleas to threats to those who don't want the status quo to change. In Barbie, Barbie's ignorant of what the Kens experience is, as many if not most men are ignorant of the experience of women in the real world, and Emmett is ignorant of how he's being manipulated and controlled by President Business. The ultimate realization for both of these characters is that a utopia of this sort will always come at the expense of someone else, and those who are different or don't fit into the dear leader's view of utopic are going to be ostracized and demonized. This idea fits into robots as well, but not through the film's protagonists. Rodney is well aware of his plight and overcomes it by encouraging class solidarity and proletariat uprising among his robot peers. Like in the Lego Movie, the oppressors and robots are specifically big business, big world industries, being infiltrated by the son-of-a-bitch mama's boy Phineas T. Ratchet, voiced by Greg Kinnear.
Oh, yeah.
Which brings me to...
Part 2. The Nature of Capitalism. How Business Manipulates and Divides. Sometimes. The goal of Phineas and Mama Ratchet is to sell overpriced and necessary upgrades to all of the robots, and therefore essentially like gentrify the poor robots out of existence because they're ugly. It seems goofy and cartoonish on paper, but when you take a look at the commentary and historical connections, it's really not that far-fetched at all. At its core, this plan and conflict presented by the Ratchets is about control, conformity, and money. All of the criticisms frequently hung on late-stage capitalism and the harm it has on its citizens. Yes, you can be you and customize yourself by buying whatever you want under late-stage capitalism, just like the robots can buy and customize whatever parts of themselves they want thanks to the Ratchets, but only if you have enough money, access to resources, and lack of care, or awareness, of the ethical implications that may come along with buying said products. And even if that's all true, you're still limited by what capitalism, or society, deems as okay to be or actually customize. More specifically, this scheme can easily be read as a metaphor for healthcare in the United States, or a commentary on predatory but useless insurance policies, anything related to technology like cars, phones, or computers, anything of the sort. But in any case, this utopia is ultimately a business scheme that divides the robots and benefits the privileged at the expense of the poor and out-of-date robots. In this sense, Rodney Copperbottom stands out because he is a unique individual with a genuine and positive goal or dream he wants to employ in order to help those around him. His entire motivation in going to see Mr. Bigwell is to show off a new invention of his, a robot that can make life easier for his dad in the restaurant. Now, confusing and weird implications about this invention having the same sentience and life value as Rodney and the rest of the robots aside, this is an altruistic and positive invention that exists just for the sake of making life better, which causes Ratchet to laugh it off as stupid, useless, and lacking an opportunity to make him money. Rodney's rejected by big business because he stands out as an altruistic individual who wants to do his own thing and help others. And also because, more simply, Ratchet just ain't interested. This creates an interesting contrast to the characters of Ken and Emmett, who have arcs dedicated to the realization they can be special, too, rather than be defined by their relationships to other people. At the beginning of Barbie, Ken only exists as an extension of Barbie, and the entire film is dedicated to his search for herself. The same goes for Emmett, who in the beginning of the film dedicates all of his time to following the instructions and being like everyone else. But in the end, Emmett discovers his sense of purpose and meaning, not because he's necessarily special or different from everybody else, but because he's just Emmett, and everyone else is everyone else. Similar to how Ken is just Ken.
Because the only thing anyone needs to be special is to believe that you can be.
In both the Lego Movie and Robots, victory comes to the heroes when they learn to unite and work together. In short, throwing off that ignorance Orwell talked about and realizing that they are intentionally being divided against each other and kept down by a ruling power. However, the characters are only required to do this because traditional pull yourself up by your bootstraps capitalism has failed them. For instance, Rodney attempts to enter the invention field in the marketplace of ideas, but is thrown out by a larger business. And when the story of the Lego Movie attempts to move Emmett into a place he doesn't belong, President Business says,
"He's not just a construction worker, Dad. He's the hero."
"Nope, he's not. He is a ordinary, regular, generic construction worker, and I need to put him back where he belongs."
In both of these cases, people who attempted to move upward or engage in class mobility are challenging the status quo and shoved back down to where the ruling class feels they are best suited. The bottom, not questioning anything, hidden from the view of the people they exist to serve. As a result, the characters have no choice but to partake in a Marxist uprising and overthrow their oppressors. Sorry, oppressors. Part 3. The Nature of Change. Maybe things shouldn't go back to how they were. While watching Barbie for the first time, I was totally digging the film, but knew it wouldn't set well with me if everything ended with the Kens and Barbies just returning to the previous roles. I was very relieved then when Barbie said maybe things shouldn't just go back to the way they were, and the Kens and Weird Barbie and Ellen start to be integrated into the workings of Barbie Land society and government. I know some people are tilted the Kens don't immediately get a Supreme Court seat or whatever, but I don't see any reason to be bothered by this, because not only is it a joke, but it's a joke that drives home the film's point of equal influence not having been obtained by women in the real world yet. The broader point is, though, that the Kens have an opportunity to get there someday, just like we do in the real world, and that a true utopia must be egalitarian in nature and include everyone to be successful. Like I mentioned at the beginning of this video, great dystopian stories rest on things not just going back to what they were. Progress requires moving forward, not slipping back in time to preserve the power of those who had it under the old status quo. In the case of the Lego Movie and Barbie, though, what's interesting is that we have a sort of reverse dystopia, where instead of trying to rebuild or recreate society, the characters have their societies threatened, or their sense of security within those societies threatened, and the stories end with those societies stronger than they were before, albeit after change for the better, both to those societies and to the characters. I like to call this the Killmonger effect, named for Eric Killmonger from the film Black Panther. Yes, Killmonger is the villain. He does bad things and wants to use his new power and influence to hurt others. However, Killmonger's motivation is an understandable and commendable one, even if his methods are deplorable. What makes Killmonger and villains like him so interesting, however, is that he points out a genuine flaw in the system of governance or control the heroes have. And in order to maintain their status as heroes, our protagonists have to change something about themselves in response to the villain. Just defeating Killmonger isn't enough. The heroes have to learn from him as well. We see a similar structure to this in Barbie, with Ken being the Killmonger figure. He's wrong, yes, but his grievances stem from some flaw of the hero, and force the hero to grow or change. This happens to a lesser degree in the Lego Movie, when Emmett manages to convince the dubious Master Builders that there's a different way to defeat President Business, by seizing the means of production and working together, and also convincing President Business himself that it's okay to be different. Part 4. Conclusion. A final thing all three of these films have in common is the commodification of bodies to encourage conformity. Barbie and Robots grapple with this the most, with Barbie engaging in some solid meta-commentary about what kind of bodily image Barbie dolls send to young girls, no matter how many different shapes and sizes Barbie come in. The film asks itself whether Barbie sets unrealistic beauty standards for girls, because no one looks like Barbie, even while it casts Margot Robbie in the lead role, who, as Helen Mirren points out, is the wrong actress to cast if you're trying to send a message about vulnerability or looking ugly. But what's powerful about Barbie, however, is that it ties these questions of appearance to questions of purpose as well, most seen in the monologue that ends with,
"And if all of that is also true for a doll just representing a woman, then I don't even know.
And of course, the penultimate scene of the film, when Barbie talks to her creator, and the Billie Eilish song, What Was I Made For, is used to just amazing effect. Robots covers the same theme, but in a more head-on approach. As mentioned, the poor, ugly, and weird robots are a threat to the shiny and prestigious Ratchet, who wants them off the street because they make him uncomfortable and remind him of his own potential mortality. This is similar to how the majority of Barbies treat and view the weird Barbie, as well as their reactions to normal human traits on stereotypical Barbie like flat feet and cellulite. In both Barbie and Robots, a large majority of the conflict rests on the character's inability to conform or meet the high standards set by capitalism, standards that are so extreme they result in the literal commodification and selling of characters' bodies, or in the case of Barbie, her entire self. While Robots covers this theme in a more material sense through commentary on beauty products, health insurance, clothes, cars, whatever, Barbie again tackles it in a more existential manner by asking who or what we are when divorced from appearance or societal expectations related to things like gender. Hence the entire motivation of Ken as a villain and his eventual redemption as a man who is Knuff. But despite their differences in how they approach the same questions, both Barbie and Robots end with the same message, and it's a message that fits perfectly into the ending of the Lego movie as well. The message is the idea that no matter what your background, you should not be limited by anything, by your gender, your economic class, your ideas. Instead, whether you are made of plastic, Legos, or spare parts, all three of these films tell us,
you can shine no matter what you're made of.
He's talking to me, Dad.
He sure is, son. He sure is.